Good evening, everyone. I'm glad to be back from Israel. Last time I was here was just before I left. And today I decided to talk about something very important. It's so important that if we're going to keep this, everything in our life is going to be wonderful. If you really think about what is the reason why so many people struggle in their life, they're not happy, depressed, anxiety attack, panic attack, anger, arguments, running after money, fighting with people, committing crimes, working like slaves, never happy, fighting with their children, fighting with their wives, fighting with their husbands, cannot focus more than 5 minutes. Every minute of their life, it's like a bomb, explosion. Did you ever ask yourself what is the reason for this? The answer is, there is one reason for all the problems I mentioned. All the problems. What is it? No faith in God. No emuna. No emuna. Now I know what you're going to say. Rabbi, we have yarmulke, we put tzitzit, we shomer Shabbat, we come to pray mincha arvit, shachrit. What do you mean no emuna? Of course we have emuna. Yes, you have emuna. But the level of emuna, it's the higher it gets, the better your life gets. The lower your emuna is, the more problems you have in your life. Now let me give you a few examples of what I'm talking about. When a person knows for sure that he has an ATM machine and he has a card from Hashem, a card, and the ATM has unlimited amount of money, whatever you need, take 1,000, 10,000, 1,000,000, 5,000,000, 1,000,000,000, no problem. Put, take, as much as you want. Will he ever steal anything from anyone? Anything. See diamonds on a table, someone forgot. $100 million diamond. Will he touch it? Never touch it. Why? Why do I need this? I have as much as I want. Why should I take someone's diamond? Why should I be a bad person? I have no reason to be a bad person. I have as much as I want. Unlimited. It will never run out. Take and take and take. The opposite. I will never touch even if people want to give me. No, I don't want gifts. Come, you work very hard. Let us give you a gift. No, I don't want gifts. Why? Nobody knows the reason. They will think, whoa, what a righteous person this guy is. We want to give him a gift he doesn't want to take. They do not know that he has as much as he wants. Why should he take your gift? Gifts cost you money. He has as much as he wants. Take and take and take. No problem. Will he ever fight with his wife about what she spend or not spend? Will he ever fight with his children about what they want, don't want, why, this, nothing? Will he ever fight with his partners in the business? No. Will he work 20 hours a day, 15 hours a day like a dog? No. He would be able to sit and learn Torah and enjoy life. He will give to people nonstop. He will never worry about anything. The Torah say clearly, in the Torah, not me. If I say it, it's a theory. But if it's written in the Torah, it's 100%. The Torah say, everything you have in your life, I gave you. Nothing comes from you. I gave you homes that you did not build, wells that you did not dig, vineyards that you did not plant. Your houses is full of all best stuff you did not fulfill. Eat, be full, just don't forget to bless your God and say thank you. Then the Torah say, you're not allowed to touch anything, it's not yours. Whatever you need, I'm in charge to give you. You don't have to be jealous with anyone. You should not feel, wow, I wish I had what the other person have. What he has is good for his own test. What you have is good for your own test. There's no reason for you to be jealous with anyone. You don't have to argue with any person ever about money. Not only that, people that have faith in God, even if somebody stole a lot of money from them, they will never take him to court. Even if they have the papers and the signatures and the lawyer and a lien, everything, they will never take him to court. They will call one time, give me what you owe me. I don't want to give you. Oh, I cannot give you. You don't deserve it. No problem. You don't want to give me? No problem. Goodbye. Finish. Never talk about it. Never complain about it. Hashem, you're in charge of all the money in the world. If I deserve this money, you're honest. You will give it to me in a different way. If I don't deserve it, what's the point? I fight with him. I take it by power. You take it away from me anyway. It's no problem. The idea of faith, that it changed your entire life. First of all, you will never ever be angry. If someone just took from you $1 million and burned it, come to the ATM, tick, 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 tick. Another million comes up. You won't even bother to fight. You won't even bother to look for him. He ran away with your money. Ran away, ran away. That's his problem with Hashem. Come to the ATM, give me. Now I know what you're thinking. Wow, beautiful story, but who has such an ATM? Who has it? The answer, everybody has it. The problem is that in order for you to know the code, you have to bring your emunah to 100% in Hashem. If you have 100% confidence in Hashem, you don't ever have to worry about money, about what people did to you, what they owe you, they don't owe you, nothing. You don't have to work. You don't have to be stressful about it. You don't have to cheat anyone. You don't have to lie to your customers. You don't have to do any of that. You don't have to steal money from the government, fake applications, all kinds of things. Like, you don't have to do all these things. Why? Because you know. Hashem made me. Yes. Anyone in the world love me more than Hashem? No. Not my father, not my mother, not my brother, not my sister, not my wife, not my children. Nobody loves me even 1% than what Hashem loves me. Because when Hashem says, I love you, that's 100% pure love. Not love because you give me money. Not love because you are my husband and I need you in my life. Not love because without you I'm miserable. Not love because I know you're going to buy me an apartment one day. No, not this kind of love. When Hashem says, I love you, you have nothing to offer to him. What are you going to offer him? Your watch? Your beautiful eyes? Everything you have, he gave it to you. It's like you come to a little child, you give him a bag of pretzel. And now you say, oh, I need him to give me one. I give you the whole thing. I need you to give me. I don't need you from you anything. So if you bring up your emunah to a very high level, your life is wonderful. First of all, if you have a lot of money, that's what Hashem wants. If you don't have a lot of money, that's what Hashem wants. How can I not be happy when God that said that he loves me so much and he decided that I don't have so much money, that I will eat very little, that I'll take a bus instead of drive a BMW. That's what he wants. That means this is the best thing for me. Nothing can ever be better than this. Because if he thought that there's a way to benefit me even more, of course he wants to do it because he really loves me. And if I suffer, he suffers with me. So if he wants me right now to be where I am right now financially or health-wise, that means this is the best thing that can happen to me. This, what I tell you right now, this is the level that every Jew must have in the Torah, must. Not only the rabbis. The Torah says, Kedoshim tiyu ki kadosh ani. You have to be holy because I'm holy. The Torah did not say the rabbis have to be holy, or the Hasidim have to be holy, or the mullah in Bukhara have to be holy. No. The Torah says to every Jew, you must be holy, men, women, old, young, smart, not so smart, rich, poor. Everybody must be holy. Everyone must have faith in me 100%. If you have faith in God 100%, you can get in a taxi when you don't have a penny in your pocket and he asks you where you want to go and you say, I have to go to Brooklyn. Okay, it's going to be $100. And if you have faith in Hashem and you know he's always going to take care of everything you need, he must give you the $100 before you get to Brooklyn. How? Leave it to him. If you live in faith with him, everything you need, you're going to get. There is one rabbi in Israel, now he's in his 70s. I met him when he was approximately maybe 50 or 40, 48. That's the first time I saw him. And he is in a very, very high level of confidence in Hashem. Very high level. Something that is hard to find in the world. To the point that one young guy went to learn in yeshiva in Jerusalem, and this rabbi lives in Jerusalem. And he said that he went with a Gemara to his house to ask him a question. He learns in yeshiva not far from his house. He came to his house, rabbi, this the Gemara say like this. He asked him questions in the Gemara. He answered him the question, then he asked him, did you pray mincha? He said, no, not yet. He said, I'm going now to the Kotel, to the Western Wall to pray mincha. You want to come with me? Such an honor. I go with such a rabbi to the Kotel. Wow, one looks at him. That's what he's thinking. Young guy, he was maybe 19 years old. He's also a son of a rabbi, this boy. So he said, of course, rabbi, I come with you to the Kotel. How are we going to go? This rabbi doesn't have a car. Doesn't drive, nothing. Watch his eyes, 100% on the street. He puts glasses, you know those reading glasses that you cannot see anything? Just not to see all the women, the faces of the wicked people. He lives in a very high level. So he said to his wife, where is the money for a cab? She said, there's 10 shekel on the shelf. 10 shekel. To go to the Kotel at that time, it was 15 shekel to get there. And 15 shekel to come back. So she said, there's 10 shekel on the shelf. So he said, okay. He took the 10 shekel and he goes down. So he said, the boy said to him, Rabbi, I didn't bring money with me. He thought maybe he's counting on me to pay for the cab. I just came to ask you a question. Didn't bring my wallet. He said, do you think I was thinking, planning to ask from you for money? It's my problem. I go to the Kotel every day to daven there. So he said to him, Rabbi, the last I took a cab to the Kotel, it's 15 shekel at least. And he said to him, why are you always so worried? Hashem knows I have to get to the Kotel to pray. This is what we have right now. That's it. The rest he's going to provide. Now this boy is not living in this league. For him, you don't have, you don't get on a cab. They pull a cab. How much to the Kotel? 15 shekel. Get in. The guy, the boy said the story. So I was shaking from the embarrassment we're about to have in 15 minutes when we get to the Kotel. He's going to say, pay me 15 shekels. The rabbi is going to say, I only have 10. Well, imagine the Chilul Hashem, such a disaster. He said, I was sitting in a cab, shaking from the embarrassment we're about to have. This driver is not even religious. Imagine what's going to happen. Sitting like this, the driver drives a little bit. Then he said to them, do you mind I pick up another passenger? No, they sit in the back. They ask him, where you have to go? He said, to the Kotel. Come in. So it's 10 shekel you, 10 shekel you. Like this. I said, by now I almost got a heart attack. I was like this. How can it be what I see in my eyes? Now he said, okay, but how are we going to come back? Let's see how the miracle is going to be. As soon as they arrive to the Kotel, they come out of the cab. One person ran to him, Rabbi, Rabbi, I'm looking for you for a month. Can I speak to you? He said, I came to pray. He said, can I give you a ride back home? We can talk on the way. 100%. So now I heard this story. I know you're not like me. You're Bukhari and you have a pure heart. You come from holy homes. So I'm sure you believe me 50%. When I heard the story, I believe it 5%. 95%, I was very skeptic. I said, hey, baloney, you and your stories. To that boy. I was thinking to myself, okay, let him tell stories. So, there was a period of time passed by, maybe a few months. Already forgot about this case that he told me. One time, there was a guy here, Israeli businessman. He called me up. He said, you used to be in banking. You know about contract. My friend is going into a deal, and he needs someone to tell him if it's a good deal. Do you mind coming with me to Manhattan? You don't have to come out of the car. He's going to come into our car. Just look at the contract, tell him if it's good or not. I said, okay. We drove to Manhattan. We went somewhere in Midtown. There's a red hair guy, yarmulke, religious guy, beard, glasses. If I remember, he had glasses. He comes into the car. He gives me the contract. I look at the contracts. Okay. I review everything. I asked him a few questions. And then he said, I said to him, yeah, it looks like a very good deal. Everything looks legit. So then the guy that took me, he said, you know who this guy is? I said, no, never met him. And this is the son of this rabbi. Who's the rabbi? The rabbi from the story. I said, oh, now it's my chance to verify. I said, oh, nice to meet you. What a schud, what an honor. You're a son of such a holy man. So I said to him, let me ask you a question. I have a question to ask you. Please tell me if it's possible or not. So I told him the whole story with his father, with a 10 shekel. So he started to smile. He said, you don't know my father? Things like this happen to him 6-7 times a day. He lives 100%. He throws everything on Hashem, and Hashem always provide for him. Always. Never let him down once. Because he's in such a level that he doesn't know what fear is. Now, I'm going to bring you to the right point right now for you to understand. If me and you will get in a cab, and he will tell us it's 15 shekel, and we will have 10 shekel in our pocket, by the time we get to the hotel, the taxi driver is going to break our face with punches. Why? Because no miracle will happen to us. So the question that I'm asking is like this. Why to this rabbi there's always miracles 6-7 times a day against the law of nature? And to us, if we have one miracle a month like this, we will be very excited. Why? That's it. The answer is he already has the password. And the password to that ATM is, Hashem, there's nothing but you, nothing in life. I throw everything at you. That's why I never steal. That's why I never lie. That's why I never trick anyone. I never touch something is not mine. I don't fight with people about money. When people ask me to connect them to someone, I never ask commission, sign here, promise me you give me commission. Right away I put them together. They want to give me money? Fine. They don't want? It's their problem. Hashem knows I worked, I deserve money. The rest is not in my hand. Then when you live like this, you don't have stress, you don't have fear, you're always happy from where you are because you know Hashem is happy, and your life becomes paradise. Now I'll tell you a story that happened 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago. I have a yeshiva in Yerushalayim. The address of the yeshiva is 21 Alephandry Street in Jerusalem. Next to Makor Baruch, close to the yeshiva of Rav Batzri. I have a yeshiva. It's called Bet Knesset Matalon. It's an ancient building. The building there is about 100 years old. You have on the wall a piece of marble from 100 years ago. And it says all the people who donate the money in liras. The time they build that shul, the Turks, the Ottomani, the Muslim Turks, they were the empire of the world. They were still in charge in Israel back then. So you see, 25 lira, 10 lira, you know, coins that doesn't even exist already for 50 years. So the rabbi in this yeshiva, his name is Rabbi Chizki. He's running the yeshiva for me. I'm not living in Israel. He's in charge. There's about 30 guys. Usually it goes up to 31, 27. Okay. It's 27 to 31 families. Sometimes we have two more, two less, and moving. That's what the budget can afford. Up to 31 avrechim. We pay them a salary every month to sit and learn all month. Small salary, only $500, which is a joke because their rent is more than 1,000. But we count on Hashem's miracle that they survive. So what happened now? This Rabbi Chizki is a very honest, simple person. He has this primitive phone, doesn't know anything, no online, doesn't know what internet is, doesn't have WhatsApp. He goes to the kotel very early to daven nets, 4 or 5 in the morning. He's a very, very unordinary person in today's world. Meaning, he's going simple with Hashem, emunah, honesty, everything. And he gives his heart for this bachurim that sit and learn there. Now, Baruch Hashem, within 2-3 months, he married his boy and his girl. someone like him doesn't have unlimited amount of money. They live very simple. It's very difficult to make in a month or two weddings. It's, although it's not Bukhari and fancy weddings, you need $500,000, but still it's a wedding. You still need a few thousand dollars for every wedding. So, after he married them, in a second wedding, they had Shabbat Chatan. It was mamash before Pesach. Well, maybe 5-6 weeks ago. The Shabbat before Pesach, he had to go buy boxes of wine for the Shabbat. When he got there, he realized after he came out of the wine store that all his cash fell. Maybe when he took some cash out, the rest fell on the floor. How much? 2,400 shekel. That's his monthly salary, more or less. It fell out of his pocket. Of course, he took it very hard to his heart. You know, wow, to lose so much money, now when I'm so tight. What can he do? He has to go into Shabbat now. Shabbat, he forgot about it. Now I'm sitting in the car with him about 10 days ago, 50, I mean, maybe 2 weeks ago, something like that. We drive in Yerushalayim. It's me, there's the guy who, my assistant in Israel, and Rabbi Chizki sits in the back. And we get a call from his son-in-law calls. Abba, yes, call this number urgent. What? Somebody found a check, blank check, it's not made for anyone, meaning the name, it's not written, but it's 9,900 shekel, about $3,000 almost, $2,800. Open check, without a name. It's just signed and written the amount. Someone found it on the street. Call him quickly. He called him, it's on a speaker now. He called that guy. The guy picks up the phone. Shalom. Listen, I'm using this story for you to understand what does it mean to live according to the Torah. And then you understand how far some of us from the truth, how far we are. This person picks up the phone and he said, yes, I heard my son-in-law just said that you found my check. He said, yes, can you give me signs? What is the check doesn't have a name on it. He said to him, yeah, I just thought about who did I give this check to. I gave it to the woman that did the catering for the Shabbat Chatan. I asked her to keep the check for a few days until I come with the cash. Once I give her the cash, give me back the check. And she gave me back the check, and I didn't even know I lost it. I forgot about it. And you probably found it. So the guy say, how do I know that really the check belonged to you? Maybe it belongs to this woman or to whoever, someone else. I'm not allowed, according to the Torah, to give you back the check because I don't know who owned the check. You used to own it, but you signed on a check. It was supposed to be. You can tell me now, hey, I promised someone cash. How do I know? Now I'm listening to this whole conversation. And I said to him, tell him to call the woman, the caterer, to verify the story. So he said to him, okay, you know what? This is the telephone number of the woman. Tell her that I gave her the check, remind her, and she will tell you that I went, I gave her the cash. Okay, I'll call you back in a few minutes. 10 minutes later, the guy called. I spoke to the woman, but I'm still not convinced that I can give you the check. Can you give me a sign? What else did you have with the check? He said, now you cannot run anywhere. Pouring rain, Baruch Hashem. So now, he say, can you tell me what else you had with the check? So he say to him, I don't remember. I didn't even remember losing the check. If you tell me what other papers you found with the check, just read the headlines, I'll tell you the rest. Just remind me what you have in your hands. Maybe you find some of my papers. You tell me what it's, you begin to read and I'll tell you the rest. He said, no, I cannot give you any hint. You have to tell me what else you had with the check. He's thinking. Then he said, did you find 2,400 shekel with that check maybe? He said, I cannot tell you. You have to give me a sign. He said, did you find money? Because I also lost 2,400 shekel. He said, okay, if you claim you lost money, describe to me how was the bills. So he said to him, 12 bills of 200 shekel. And the guy said, not good enough. Give me another sign. Listen to this. Thinking, what other sign? That's all, I lost this money. Then he remembered it was all bills. The old bills in Israel are red, 200 shekel. Now they made blue. They changed it to blue. He said to him, it was 12 bills, all red. Red, it's already out of the market. It's like an old $100 bill. He said to him, right, now you gave me a good sign. You can come pick up the cash and a check, open check, 9,900 shekel. He could have write the check to his name and there's nothing legally you can do, nothing. Because once you give an open check, whoever writes his name, he owed me the money, finished. Not only did not do such thing, he kept the cash as well. So now, right away, he sent his son-in-law to go get the cash and this. When his son-in-law was there, he found out that this guy is a sofer. Sofer, he writes mezuzot. When I find out, I told him, go quickly, get for me a sample of his writing. I want to buy hundreds of mezuzot from this guy every year. Why? Because when you buy a mezuzah from a sofer, you don't know who he is. He has beautiful handwriting, that's all. You don't know how honest he is. Tomorrow he make mistake in the name of Hashem. After he worked 2 hours, 3 hours, he chas v'shalom can erase it, fix the mezuzah, you will never know. You take the mezuzah to check, wow, beautiful mezuzah, amazing. You don't know that he took a razor and cleaned some of the letters and rewrite, which is sometimes against the halakha. For instance, if you make a mistake in a mezuzah, but you didn't realize, you continue to write a few more words, and then you look now back and you find out you made a mistake. You have to erase all the words that you wrote after the mistake to go all the way back to the mistake. You have to shave everything with a razor, go back to the mistake, fix the mistake, and continue. Because when you write the mezuzah, the only way the mezuzah is kosher, if you write the 713 letters in the mezuzah by the right order. 1, 2, 3, 10, 20, 50, 100, 200. If you do not write it in the right order, it's not kosher. So you cannot go where the mistake isn't fixed. Because you continue already. You have to erase everything all the way back to the mistake, fix the mistake, and continue to write. There's only one problem. Sometimes you already wrote the name of Hashem after your mistake. If you wrote the name of God after your mistake, you're not allowed to delete the name of God. You're not allowed to erase the name of God. So you have to take the mezuzah and bury it. How long you work? 2 hours. 2 hours with a feather. Some people, they're greedy. They need money. They're not so righteous. They delete everything. Hashem irachem. Or they just go to where the mistake is and fix it anyway. And put the mezuzah in the market. If you don't know who the sofer is, you don't know him well, you don't know he's a real tzaddik, honest, it's very dangerous. So I say, after such a thing, you can sleep well at night and know this tzaddik will never do such thing. He has cash, found cash. For 1 month he was looking for him. Because the telephone number on the check was his previous apartment. And there was nobody there. He went from one person to the other in Yerushalayim. Do you know anybody by this name, Rabbi Chaim Chizki? Until one person said, yeah, I know him. Where is he? In the yeshiva over there. Call up the yeshiva. This came, asked. His son-in-law was there. He was here. He found your check. How much he bothered to find him? Sometimes people say, I will hold it a month. If I find the person, fine. If not, I'll use it. He did not give up. He looked everywhere. So he said to me, you don't understand how happy I am now. when I got this money back. First of all, it's very hard for me to lose so much money. I mean, yes, in America it's not so much money, you know, but for him it was a lot of money. And not only that, he said, I was thinking to myself, why Hashem give me such a punishment? I don't steal from anyone. I don't lie. I pay on time. Nobody ever can complain about something I did wrong. Why do I have to lose money? That means I'm guilty of something. But then when the money comes back, you know, it was all a test from Shamayim. After so long, you got the money back. So you see, Rabotai, when you live with Emunah, you live with Emunah, you never touch what's not yours. You never lie. You don't lie to the insurance. You don't have to fake. If the insurance paid you for the diamond that your wife lost and 2 weeks later she found it in a corner somewhere, you call back the insurance. I want to give you back the money. You gave me the money, but I found the diamond ring. You make Kiddush Hashem. You make sure they know you're Jewish. You tell them on the phone, listen, I'm a religious Jew. I cannot take your money. It doesn't belong to me. These things sometimes even make it to television. And it's very big Kiddush Hashem. Very big Kiddush Hashem. But you have to make sure when you return the money that they know you're Jewish. If you come without kippah, no nothing. How would they know you're Jewish? You know, just give it back. It's no Kiddush Hashem. So going back to what I started. This guy, because he's honest, because he returned the money, Hashem made sure that he will reach Rabbi Chizki when I am in the car. Why? Because Hashem wants to give this guy a proof that nobody ever lost by being honest. No one. And once you're going to find him, I'm going to sit next to him and I'm going to order hundreds of mezuzot from him and he have parnasana for the rest of his life. Doesn't have to find customers. Right away I told him, prepare 500 mezuzot. Every house here in America is 20 mezuzot and up. Quickly they run. It's not like in Israel. 4, 5, that's it. You have big houses here in New York. People need a lot of mezuzot. One time I went to Riverdale. One Persian woman, she asked me, they build a beautiful house, they need mezuzot. I asked, how many mezuzot you need? She said, many, a lot, bring a lot. How much is a lot? 20, 30, 40. How much is a lot? Bring 100, she said. 100 mezuzot? I said, 100 mezuzot, it's a hotel. She said, bring a lot, don't worry. If you have leftover, you take it back. I say, okay, I can't bring it to you. No, but I also need you to put them for me. I have 100 mezuzot to put. It's 2 days' work. She said, bring someone with you. I'll pay. Don't worry. I got one guy from the yeshiva. She gave this guy a tip, $300. Yeshiva, Bachur Yeshiva, he helped me to put the mezuzot. I came to her house all day. Me and the guy, from the morning until the evening, we put mezuzot over there. It just not end. Another room, and another one, and over here, and attic, and this. More than 80 mezuzot we put. They have a pool, indoor pool, in the house, and just the pool alone has 10 gates. You know these pools? You have 10 mezuzot only right there to enter to the room of the pool. Now I went to her bedroom, bigger than this big shul, the bedroom, and closet all the way from here to the other side. You know those closets that have 2 doors? One and another one. Walk-in, but long, very long. I look at the floor, 300 pairs of shoes. All color, black, brown, green, red, high heels, low heels, this, that. Everything on the floor. Because they didn't put the shelves yet. So I'm looking at the closet. It's so big. The closet also needs mezuzot. Why? You can put beds inside. You can live inside. It's a room. It's a walk-in. It's a room. Once it's bigger than 6x6, it needs mezuzot. But how many mezuzot the closet needs? Because it has a set of 2 doors, frame, and another frame, and another frame. So 2 doors and 2 doors. So it needs maybe 4 or 5 mezuzot, just the closet. So I'm thinking to myself to put 4 mezuzot here or no? So I'm looking at all these shoes. So the woman started to smile. She's very shy. She smiled. She said, what can I do, Rabbi? I'm obsessed with shoes. Women love shoes. You understand? So, mezuzot, it's very interesting because with this woman, at least, she said, bring the best mezuzot. I don't care about money, and I want you to put them for me correctly. Whatever it costs, it costs. Sometimes you come to people, they build a home, $3 million to build. It's probably worth six. They build the most expensive stuff. Then you say, what kind of mezuzot you have? I have for $68, I have for $75. In a store, it's a lot more expensive. This is directly from the sofer. Come on, Rabbi, don't you have something cheaper? Why it has to be so expensive? $75 for mezuzah? What's this? Say, no, it's not. Well, you think it's a piece of paper? It's a leather from the cow. They remove the skin, they remove the hair, they put it in lime until they cut it, until they make lines, until they prepare the ink, and then you have to take a feather and you dip it in the ink, and until you fill up 713 letters, it can take 3-4 hours to write a mezuzah. It's very cheap, 75. What kind of a professional person agreed to work 3 hours for $75 when $10 you buy the cloth, $3 for the person that make the crowns, $3 for the computer check, another $3 for the person who go over it and check. So your cost is already more than $20, your cost before you start. And then after you sell it for 75 or 68, how much you have left? $50 profit? And from $50 took you 3 hours. It's not a lot. The guy in the supermarket that wrapped the product makes just as much. So he will build a house for $3 million, but will try to save $100 or $200 on a mezuzot. Makes sense to you? Technically, it doesn't make sense. But in reality, it makes perfect sense. To build a house and spend $3 million, there is no yetzer hara against it. The Satan is interested. You're going to make a show off, and everyone will be jealous, and people are going to start talking against you. It's only serve the Satan's purpose. But to put expensive mezuzot and good ones, the Satan doesn't want. Right, the way he puts in your hand, look at this rabbi, he's greedy. He came to steal your money. Don't be a fool. Don't let this rabbi fool you like he fool everybody else. Rabbi, don't you have cheaper tefillin? Chandelier, he goes with his wife, they need 10 chandeliers. 2,000, 4,000, 7,000, 13,000. How much? 13,000. I need 10. No problem, here. 10 chandeliers, no complaints. Tefillin? Rabbi, come on, you have to find something cheaper. It's too much, $700 tefillin, come on. How long does it take to make tefillin? 1 year. 1 year of work. You know how difficult to make tefillin? Handmade, 100% handmade. To make a pair of shoes by hand, no machines, no made in China. Handmade. How long does it take? From the minute you take off the skin from the cow or from the pig, you remove the hair and all that, until you make it, you make the sole, you make the shape, you cut, you sew. How long does it take to make a pair of shoes? It can take a few full days, from morning to night. Pair of shoes. How much are you going to pay for handmade shoes? Probably $2,000-$3,000. Only shoes. No writing inside, nothing. Just handmade. There's places in Manhattan, shoe repair. One guy told me this is father business, his grandfather business, almost 100 years old in Manhattan. People bring boots to fix, $200, $300 to fix. To fix? How much it's worth? $1,500, brand new, $2,000, crocodile, all kinds of shoes from the rich people. $200, $300 to repair. But tefillin? Tefillin? Wow, so much. One time, there's one Bukharian guy in Miami, lo alenu, he had cancer. Young man was maybe married only for a few years, had little kids. Baruch Hashem, he came out of the cancer. Baruch Hashem. That was maybe 5 years ago. They invited me to go there to speak in his event. there was also a lot of people from New York went there, and they make a party in a big place with Sifrei Torah. Much looked like a wedding. Daddy, Baruch Hashem, he survived. We had Shabbaton in his house, in his parents' house. Then when we sit in a place, all of a sudden I see all the people run to the entrance. All the people run. So what happened? Who came? Maybe the chief rabbi came. Maybe Eliyahu Navi came. Oh, I see. Big black guy. Like a gorilla, big, muscular, like this. So many gold chains. Everything rings, these earrings. And few bodyguards, each one of him. You know, if you make a move and he give you one punch, that's it. Itgadal v'itgadash mirabba. Bodyguards like this. And this guy himself, very muscular, tall. I see, I look at his shoes, all gold shoes, tons of necklaces. Came in like this, everybody ran to him. I said to one of the Bukharians over there, who is this guy? He said to me, that's the biggest rap singer, Florida. I remember the name because it sounds like Florida. Florida! I said, what's so special about him? Rabbi, he's our best customer. You see all his rings? $500,000, all his necklaces. This, that, you see his shoes? $150,000 shoes made out of gold. Shoes with gold. He said to me, ah, Rabbi, that's nothing. You want to see what car he has? $1.5 million. What car costs $1.5 million? What's a helicopter? Bugatti. Bugatti. And how the religious guys are so excited, like Rav Ovadia Yosef came. So I said, what is he doing here in the event of the religious Jews here? Rabbi is the best customer. We know how to treat a customer. Shoes! $150,000. Shoes from gold. A Jew can walk with shoes made out of gold. The Jew has $10 billion cash. He can make shoes from gold. He can go with 500 pieces of gold on him. This is what Hashem wants. If a Jew only think before he does what he does, 90% of what he's doing, he will immediately not do. Even if it's not written in the Torah that it's not allowed. It's not written in the Torah that you're not allowed to wear a lot of gold and necklaces and bracelets. He doesn't really say it clearly. But everybody with a brain understands that that's the last thing Hashem wants. I'll go like this on the street, show off, look at me. I'm here. Hey! Did not tell me anything about my new necklace. Come on. Watch! Ah, Rabbi, you saw the watch? $100,000. And you have five like this in a safe. $500,000 watches, no problem. You come to him and say, the guys in Yeshiva starve all month. They learn Torah. They make Hashem so happy. Give a few thousand a month. Why should I give them money? Let them go to work. I work. You live thanks to them. What do you mean why you should give them money? Without them, you'd be dead a long time ago. All the Jews in the world live thanks to the Bachurei Yeshiva. That's what the Torah says, not me. The Torah says, Im lo briti yomam valayla, if you don't learn Torah day and night, around the clock, there is no existence to the world. Chukot shamayim va'aretz lo samti. I do not keep the world another day. The laws of nature, sun, moon, day, night, all be canceled. If you don't go around the clock and learn Torah. The Torah is the gasoline of the world. One time Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul, Zatzal, very big tzaddik, rabbi, mekubal, in Yerushalayim, in Porat Yosef Yeshiva. He comes into the yeshiva, he sees one guy is standing on the street looking at the bulletin board, reading the advertisement. He said to him, run, run, run with me, it's an emergency, run, run. The guy said, what happened, Rabbi? He begins to run. Run faster. He's an old man. He runs. The young guy started to run. Run, run, run. Run, emergency, scream. The guy said, wow, who knows what happened? He ran into the yeshiva. He said, sit, sit here, sit. He ran quickly. He got the Gemara. He opened the Gemara. Learn, learn. The guy said, phew, Rabbi, you scared me. What is this? I thought something happened. He said, listen, let me ask you a question. Do you have faith in Hashem or no? So of course, there is a God or no? Of course there is a God. The Torah is from God or no? Of course. The biggest mitzvah is to learn Torah or no? Of course. What does the Torah say? That when you learn Torah, you give life to the whole world. Thanks to you, you save the world. So why do you have time to read bulletin, all this advertisement? You're not responsible. It's like a soldier who leaves his army place. You're supposed to be a pilot. Now you go play Sheshbesh. What do you do, Mr. Pilot? I'm not in a mood to fly to Syria to fight the Iranians. What do you mean? We count on you. No, I like to play chess. With some good vodka. I drink. I'm happy. It's not responsibility. You understand? You're not responsible. So far, any questions about what I say? Do you believe that there is a way to live with 100% faith and be happy and never ever to be upset or to fight or to be greedy or to run or to be jealous or to have ego and anger and fights? Do you think you can get rid of all of it? Work on your emunah in Hashem. En od milvado, like Rav Chaim Mivolozhin say, whenever you have a problem in life, close your eyes and think. En od milvado. There is nothing but Hashem. If Hashem wants me to have this, it's in His hand. If He wants to save me, it's in His hand. Everything else, it's all a show, a cover-up. It's me and Hashem. That's the way the world is. Nothing else. His guy, that guy, this messenger, that police, this guy, kol shtuyot. Right now, Hashem made a decision about you. Yes or no? I remember when I came to America in 1989. I didn't know anything about America. I did not know anything about America. I didn't know what religion is, what Shabbat is. I didn't know nothing about this country. I had only $700 when I came to America, 1989. Father is not rich. Gave me some money, that's it. Besides buying me the ticket, gave me a few $100 to come here. I went to live in Great Neck. My father had a brother, a friend, and the friend has a brother. This brother used to come to Israel every July and August, sitting on the beach on Bat Yam. We got friendly, me and him. He has no kids. Look how Hashem turned the whole thing around. I was playing a little bit Sheshbesh with him. I saw that he has ego and anger, so I let him win. He liked me. My father asked his brother, maybe he will take my son to America. There's nothing to do in Israel, no jobs. He asked his brother, he's bored, he lives in Great Neck in a house, there's no kids, no nothing. He said, yeah, why not? He can come. He can come. So I went to him, this is how I started everything. I came here. So I said to him, after a few days I found a job in a bagel store. I worked there for a few months. I saved a few $1,000. I said to him, I need to buy a car. Until now I was using his wife's car, his car, but I need a car. He said, I have a friend, he's a car dealer. Israeli guy, long hair, look like JC. You know how the statue of JC in Brazil? That's how this Israeli guy looked. But for me, today I would never do business with a guy like this. But back then, what did I know from my life? He's a car dealer. I said, okay, let me go buy a car from him. I went to buy a car, he sold me an old Buick. A few hundred dollars, maybe, $700. For me, it looked like a Mercedes, because in Israel, who has a Buick back in time? Even though it was very old Buick, but for Israeli, it was, wow. Now I drive Friday night, Ba'avonotai Arabim, Shabbat. I go to Manhattan to make scenes. What happened? Midtown Tunnel, the guy said to me, where is your registration? Why do I know? I just bought a car from a car dealer. He told me he's going to take care of everything. I don't know anything about America. I don't know how to buy a car. I count on him that he's a friend of the guy that I stay by him. He's going to give me a legit car. Who would ever think that he sold me a stolen car? Stolen car. So he said to me, pull to the side. They check. He said, the plate does not match the car. He put a plate on it. Unbelievable, these crooks. So he took advantage of me. So I said to him, listen, I bought this from a guy. I can tell you his name. Check. He said, listen, I know that I can see that you don't look to me the type that will steal a car, but by law I must arrest you. I must arrest you, and we're going to try to get a hold of this guy until then. We'll see what's Friday night. Arrest you, that means until Monday you're in jail with the biggest monsters on earth over there. And I wear a nice jacket, this. They put me over there, a young Jew, Israeli, 21, 22 years old. I sit over there in a jail, Erev Shabbat. I see all these people looking at me. I already read their mind, what they're planning. We all sit in one room. This guy is drunk, this guy is drug addict. One guy is sleeping on the floor. They slowly, slowly come closer to me. They don't know I'm a Jew, but they know as a white boy, you know, cream. They come closer to me. Out of nowhere, Hashem sent this Puerto Rican gangster. 2 minutes before that, he started to talk to me. What are you doing here? What did you do? I tell him the story. He felt bad for me that someone tricked me with a car. Where are you from? From Israel. I'm from Puerto Rico. Nice to meet you, man. Then, when they started to come close to me, say, hey, nobody touched this guy. Now, Hashem sent me a protector. Now I'm there. They say, the guy tell me, now you're not coming out of here until Monday morning. You won't see a judge until Monday. I almost killed myself. Ma, an hour here I'm dying. An hour here I say, wow, you need the bathroom. Nobody cares. Nobody comes there. There's nothing you can do. So all of a sudden I see a policeman come, red hair, mustache. Who would believe a Friday night out of nowhere? A Jewish policeman, Star David, necklace he had, Star David. Right away I screamed to him, excuse me, come here, I'm a Jew. Technically today when I think about it, big deal, you're a Jew, I'm a Jew, I care about Jew. He came to me, said, what are you doing here? I realized, well, this guy's doing. Told him quickly the story. I said, listen, my life is in risk here. I need the bathroom, help me out. 1 second, open it. Took me to the bathroom. Okay. Now I relax. At least I went to the bathroom. On the way back from the bathroom, I tell him, listen, if I'll be here until Monday, I'll be dead here. He said to me, listen, there's no judges. But you know what? I know a judge. I did once a favor to this judge. Let me call him up, see if he's gonna... What's your name? No problem, I'll go. 2 hours later, he came. Mizrachi! I got up. You coming with me? Friday night, no judge, no nothing. Dismiss the case. When I go out, who do I see? The crook. The car dealer. They went and brought them in. They realized it. But whatever, this guy let me go. You see, Hashem is saving you. Gam ki elech begeit salmavet lo yirara ki ataimadi. But I was not smart enough back then to see the hand of Hashem. Friday night, you live like a goy. You don't have anything to me. I send you to the worst place, and I send you over there, mamash, salvation. Instead of coming out, beginning to think how Hashem saved me. Right away, go back to the scene. Sometimes a person doesn't even see how much Hashem is doing. Before I came here, I went to see a friend of mine from childhood. He lives here more than 20 years. He said, I want to sit and talk to you. We talk about life, about things. He told me how many problems he had in life. Amen. And how many times Hashem saved him, and he's still not Shomer Shabbat. So I said to him, I don't understand. Hashem saved you from bankruptcy. Hashem saved you from the mafia. Hashem saved you from the Israeli government. Hashem saved your wife's life. She was almost dead against all odds. Hashem saved you so many times. This is what you've been telling me in the last half an hour. What do you wait for? What are you waiting for? You want Hashem to give you one final punch that's it? There's no more return? He said to me, you're right, it's not me, it's my wife. I said, next week, you bring your wife here. You bring her here and we sit. In half an hour, I make sure she becomes Shomer Shabbat. And I told him a story that happened to me in Israel. I was three Shabbats in Israel. The first Shabbat, I met Shabbaton in Afula. I had a very rich guy. He came with his wife and his daughter with the car on Friday night. Friday night, he drives. When we left to shul, the car wasn't there. When we come back, we see the car is there in a parking. We sit on Friday night in the table. He is a grandson of a very, very big rabbi. One of the biggest rabbis of Morocco of all times. Not just a big rabbi. The biggest in the world. His father was one of the top rabbis in the world. Thousands of people don't move a step without his father's permission. That's how big he was. Holy, writes books. Can't say the name. Bigger than a Baba Sali. His grandfather was the biggest authority in Morocco. Baba Sali is a big chacham and a very big tzaddik, but his father was the top authority. Top. You don't move without asking him in halacha. Even Rav Ovadia Yosef uses his grandfather all the time when he writes his answers. And he, the grandson, mechalel Shabbat. But make millions, millions of dollars every year in Israel. In Israel, it's big money. I see it, I talk to his daughter, I talk to him, to his wife. Then I say to him, not everyone has unlimited amount of chances. You lived almost all your life not Shomer Shabbat. Why are you waiting until Hashem, God forbid, will give you a punch and there will be no return from there? Excuses, excuses, excuses! Went back in the car and left. Drove back to Tel Aviv. It's an hour drive. So, I eat my heart. Every time I go to Israel, it burns my heart. On Shabbat, I was now in a hotel last Shabbat. I look from the window in Jerusalem, thousands of cars on the highways. It kills me to see all these Israelis living a lie, mechalele Shabbat, lagoyim. And I'm thinking to myself, they only knew now they're making a sin which is worse than a murder in the eyes of Hashem. Would they drive? Of course not. How do I get to all these people to wake them up? But this guy, we know him. Personal. He married to my cousin. I warned him, but he doesn't listen. 3 days later, stroke in his brain. In a hospital in critical condition. My mom is calling. Pray for him. He just had a stroke. I said, look at this world. I begged him. I almost cried. Begged him to not to be Mechalel Shabbat. I warned him from what's coming. It's just a matter of time, because I know how Hashem runs the world. He doesn't listen, and now I have to pray for him. I have to pray for his refuah. Baruch Hashem, we did pray for his refuah. That night I made a lecture for his refuah. They injected something into his system. Maybe it's going to open something clogged in his brain. Well, maybe a crash of blood or something. It did not work. They had to open up his head, do a brain surgery. The brain surgery. Then the doctor said, thank God we opened the head, because if this liquid that we put in would work, it would not fix the whole problem. And he could, chas v'shalom, die. The fact that it did not work and we had to open the head, we saw that there is another problem we didn't know about, and we fixed it. And after a few hours he woke up, but he's still half paralyzed in half of his body. The whole right side is paralyzed. To be honest with you, I don't know in the last 3 days what's the update on his condition. But God forbid, imagine now he's going to have to lay in bed for the next 25, 30 years of his life. This could have been prevented with no doubt in my mind. If he would say to me that Friday night after I proved to him that it's a very, very big sin to be Mechalel Shabbat, he would say to me, okay, that's it, no more. That's the last Shabbat I broke. Nothing would happen to him. Because the idea that Hashem punished people is not because he wants. It's either to wake them up or because the Satan comes and he has a claim and Hashem doesn't have what to answer. No te'ana. Hashem cannot do anything. Hashem cannot do whatever he wants. Hashem is a judge. is a fair judge. You have the prosecutor, is the angel, the Satan. The Satan keeps complaining. How much are you going to give this guy? Another house, and another car, and another million, and another million. His grandfather was the light of the world. Look at him like a goy. How long are you going to tolerate his work? And what happened in the end? At one point, HaKadosh Baruch Hu cannot anymore ignore the Satan claims. Just like the court. The judge can tell you, my young man, my heart is for you. I gave you one chance, second chance. You did not, I'm sending you 2 years to prison. But why, judge? I promise I'm going to stop with the drugs. You promise first time, you promise second time. This is the third time. My hands are tight. I gave you enough chances. I know a young boy. He went in front of a judge for using heroin. You know, once you use heroin, it leads to steal and to take things from the store and not to pay. You don't even know where you are. You know how it is. Then you drive a car without a license, this, you go against traffic, because your mind is not in this world. So one thing leads to another, then you get arrested, and sometimes they have too much drugs on you, so now they try to pin you for being a distributor of drugs, and you're only a stupid kid from a good family that started to get involved with the wrong people on the street, and they messed up your life. So he went to court, they give him a chance, okay. Then they gave him another chance. Then the judge said to him, technically now, I have to send you minimum 6 months to prison. But you know what? I'm not going to do it. Because this morning, listen to this, this morning, two young boys that stood in front of me a week ago, I had a case open with them. They both died. They both died. So, what's the point of sending you to prison? Anyway, it's not going to fix the problem. Do you want to help yourself go to rehab or no? If you tell me that you're giving me a word and you're going to go to rehab and you're going to get clean, I'm letting you go now. I'm supposed to lock you in now because it's the third time you're here. But I want to get a promise from you because I want you to leave. I don't want to hear about you that you died also. What happened? Yes, judge, yes, 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 of course. And he went up, and he went, this time he kept his word. He went to rehab, and somehow he got out of it. He's on the 5% that get out of it. Most of the kids don't get out of it. I can show you now a picture today. Today I got it. 23 years old girl. Look at her face. Look like an angel face. An angel face. And what's with her? Died from overdose. Overdose. Here, I don't want to put it in front of the camera, so I'll hold it. Look at her. Look at this face. 23 years old. Died.
Here or Israel?
In England. It's all over. Israel also. Here, also. Here the worst. Here in New York, the worst. Here in America, the worst. How many kids died from drugs? Some of them Bukharians here in a community. Do you know that some families buried their children and they're embarrassed to tell you? You don't even know they died. Where is your son? He went to LA. What is he doing there? Working. In what? Real estate. Oh yeah? Damn, thank God. Wow. Good. I'm happy he made it. He's already buried a month. They're embarrassed to say. They don't want anyone to know. More than 150 kids died from drugs in the last year, all from religious homes. The non-religious home, I don't know.
65,000.
That's in America.
Last year.
65,000 in America. But I'm talking 150 religious families. I don't know, but from the secular family, could be another few thousand Jews and Goyim and all together.
250 Jews died this last year.
250 Jews. Understand? Thank you very much. Good night. We're almost done. Thank you. So, Rabotai, to conclude, today I decided to speak about Emunah because I see I'm still in shock from my visit in Israel. Why? That's what got me now to talk a lot about Emunah. Because I saw how religious people behave in a business. It drove me out of my mind. False promises. Cheating, lying, deceiving, promising, not keeping a promise, agreeing with your one thing, giving you something completely different, making an appointment with you the next day at 12 p.m., don't even show up, don't call, make another appointment again, don't show up, building a home, stealing from your property. You try to be a decent builder in Israel. I was with this guy. He's a builder. He builds homes. Nothing is left. The Arabs steal. They steal his electric cords. They steal his tools. They steal the drills. Then the Jews come and the Jews steal. And then the real estate guy, he comes and he steals. To the point that even you put lights in a house, the next day come, the light bulbs are missing. Somebody stole a piece from the bathroom, you know, the plastic that covered the bathroom. He comes the next day, two screws like this. It's not there. How are you going to live like this? How? People get on a bus, they don't pay, they go from the back door, there's all kinds of tricks like this. Hard to believe what's happening. If you're a goy, if you're a secular Jew, all your life you live like a goy, you don't know, you don't believe in Hashem, you don't never hear Torah, you don't know what's the end of the thieves, and how much you're going to pay in Olam Haba, in Gehenom, in hell, for every penny you've stole. I understand. You think, I don't have enough, this guy is rich, let me take from him a little bit. It's not the end of the world. He won't feel. Because you don't have the right ideology. You don't understand how Hashem gets angry when you steal from something is not yours. Or things like this. You know, I had the merit to make the biggest gangster in the history of Israel, to make him very religious man. Murderer, head of the drug dealing, head of the prostitution, head of the mafia, head of the collection. In Israel, they used to have a newspaper called Ha'olam Hazeh, this world. The old Israelis that are young, older than 60 and up, they will tell you about this. This used to be 30 years ago. Every week, they bring the biggest gangsters in Israel. Every week, he was on the front page. That's how big of a gangster this guy was. All his body's tattoos, all his body's muscles, all his face are holes and scars. You just look at him, your blood is freezing. One person told me that he went one time to Manhattan to a Korean guy to buy his girlfriend a ring or a bracelet. The Korean guy saw him, said, take, 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 how much, he said. He has a loud voice, how much? Free gift for the young girl, gift. He was so scared, he was about to rob him. Take for free. This is how one time this guy told me, if you come to King's Highway, you don't have to put quarters in the meters. Back then, used to put quarters in the meter. I said, why? He said, just put on the windshield my name. Nobody will touch your car. So I laugh. I thought it's a joke. Then one guy looks at me and says, why are you laughing? He means it. Put the name of this guy, nobody touch your car. This is the kind of guy. You don't understand the stories he told me, what he used to do. Now, this guy, one time he came to a lecture of mine in the house of his brother in Brooklyn. He wasn't even supposed to be there. He was there. For 2 hours he heard the lecture. His eyes almost came out. He came to me, said, I want to put tzitzit. We had tzitziot, we gave out. Put tzitzit, say, his partner was there, a blonde guy. He said, don't dare to give him tzitzit. I said, why? He's a cold blood killer. I said, what do you mean? Say, we went one time to kill someone. They gave us the map of the second floor, where the bedroom is. We came out, we have mask on our face. Tell me the story. We're ready to shoot. The young boy came out of the room, little kid. I couldn't shoot. This guy doesn't have a gun. Shot the man in front of his own kid. You want to put tzitzit on him? One sentence I told him made him religious. That moment, Hashem put words in my mouth. Hashem said, it's horrible. Wow. but I want you to know, מחלל שבת is a bigger criminal than him. מה? He said to me, what are you talking about? I said, yes, in the Torah, מחלל שבת is a bigger punishment than a murderer. Bigger punishment. So, מחלל שבת, what's מחלל שבת? Almost killed me. I said, I proved to you, in the Torah. Slowly, slowly, he started to be in touch. He came to my house in Chol HaMoed of Sukkot in Monsi. Back then I lived in a Hasidish neighborhood, all Hasidim. And he came like this with his sunglasses and his muscles like this. All the Hasidim saw him. They all ran to hide in the house. They picking up like this. He sits in my Sukkah. He has such a loud voice. Everyone is speaking. What's going on here? But you had to see this guy. Why I remembered him now? Because once he became religious, he was religious for real. What does it mean for real? I'll tell you a story. One time I was with him in Brooklyn. It was close to the kosher gym. I'll never forget that day. It was maybe 3 o'clock in the afternoon. He got a call from the biggest gangster family in Israel, Alperon. Everyone knows them. The biggest mafia. One of the brothers, Alperon, calls him up. He said to him, I heard that you're angry at me for the $17,000 that we owe you. This is the conversation in Hebrew. Why are you angry? What, you don't count on me? He say, listen, I don't want the money. Don't send me the money. This guy, which is the biggest gangster in Israel, started to shake on the phone. No, no, don't say this. He was afraid that he's going to kill him. He said, don't say it. Give me 1 hour. My brother will send you the money by 4 p.m. It was 3 p.m. In 1 hour, you're going to get the $17,000. He said, don't send me the money. I don't want the money. The guy said, please, I'm begging you. Don't talk like this. We brothers. He said, I told you, don't. He's angry. He has a loud voice. Don't send, in Hebrew, don't send me the money. It's dirty money. I became religious. He had to see the guy on the other phone. What? Are you joking with me? First of all, the guy had such a huge relief. Because he thought, that's it, his life is over. I became religious. You became religious? You religious? Say yes. I became religious. I don't want to touch this money. You had to see how this guy became. He went to live in a basement in Brooklyn. One time he told me, I have to fix my teeth. I don't have money. I'm dying from pain. So why are you up all night? I have pain in my teeth. This is a guy, everybody bowed down to him. Doesn't want to touch the dirty money. 5 o'clock, he was in shul. He was also Levi. He goes up to the Torah in Brooklyn, in a synagogue. Became very religious. Once he stopped with the nonsense, he stopped 100%. You don't stop one leg here, one leg there. One leg here, one leg there, you didn't do that much. You want to be half mechalel Shabbat, half shomer Shabbat, it's not going to work. Half holy, half not holy, it's not going to work. Half eating kosher, half not eating kosher, it's not going to work. You want it to work? Do it 100%. Don't trick Hashem. You can trick the whole world. You're tricking yourself. You don't trick anyone. You have faith in me or no? You count on me or no? I want to ask you a question. If Hashem comes to you, and we'll finish with this. If Hashem comes to you and say to you, I want you to go now to the Empire State Building, say Shema Israel, and jump from the roof into the street. 34th Street over there. Don't worry. Count on me. I would land you safely. In your head, you know 100% Hashem is not a liar. Right? If your own biological father say to you, don't worry, I'm going to take care of you. I'll take care of the problem. Then you know he's going to do it. If Hashem say, I would land you safely, then you know for sure in your head, that you're going to land safely. Would you jump? Yeah. I would be afraid to jump.
Me too.
I'll be honest with you. I would stand over there and see what's going on. And before I jump, my heart will go 500 beats per minute. Maybe in the end I'm going to somehow force myself to jump. Maybe, yes. But I'm going to be shaking. I may get a heart attack before I jump even. That's a natural reaction. But really, in reality, if you're 100% sure you have a parachute and another safe one, a backup one, that's no problem. You wouldn't be so worried. Look how they jump from the planes. They're not worried. Why? Because they have a parachute. And if that's not going to work, they have a reserve one. Right? But still there are some accidents. Sometimes it rolls like this and you get stuck and you faint sometimes. It can be a lot of other things. Well, people jump. Why? Because they count on a parachute. Hashem is much safer than a parachute. If you know it in your brain, but you're still afraid. The key in this world is to have full confidence in Hashem. Ein roa v'ozen shomad v'chol ma'asecha b'sefer nichtavim. There's an eye who watch over you. There's an ear who listens to you. And everything you do is recorded in the book of God. What for? One day you'll be judged for it. I saved you from this. I saved you from that. You want to be real tzaddikim and real appreciative? I'll give you a good advice. Make a diary, a notebook. As of today. Today, what is it? May 10? Write a diary. May 10, 2018. Write it down. Every day, write how many miracles Hashem made for you. How you got this customer out of nowhere. How you almost got hit by a car. How you were texting and driving. And the last second when you picked up your head, a truck in front of you just stopped. The last second you picked up. Another half a second you would not pick up your head, you'll be dead. All these miracles. How you made it to the flight. How you were supposed to make it and something went wrong and you got saved. How you got saved from this crook and how this. All the things that happened. Write it down in a notebook. Every time you feel weak, go open this book. Even Achashverosh had such a book. Achashverosh in Megillat Esther, one day he couldn't sleep, they brought him that book. He opened it up, he saw Mordechai saved his life. That's how we all got saved and we're sitting here today. Without that book of Achashverosh, who knows where we would be? You get the point here? This will remind you how much you owe Hashem. When you know how much you owe Hashem, it will feel very bad to go against his word. When you know I owe you so much, how can I tell you no? You know how sometimes you have friends, you call them up, I need a little favor from you. A little? Anything is mine is yours. You saved my life. Just name it. Whatever you want. They mean it. Because this is people that have appreciation and they're grateful. Some people are ungrateful. What can you do? Our job as Jews is to be grateful to people and needless to say to Hashem. No matter how much a person did for you, it's nothing compared to how much Hashem does for you every second. Every minute, every hour, every day. Millions of sins every day. He said not to eat this, how do you dare to eat it? He said not to touch it, how do you dare to touch it? All these things. He said Shabbat is important for me, it's a covenant, it's an agreement. It's the agreement between me and you, how do you dare to turn the television on? Or the phone or the car? Or the cigarette. How? Once you get Yirat Shamayim, it's going to be a lot easier to be religious. You need to learn Torah, you need to listen to lectures. That's why I give so many CDs for free. We get millions of them until now. Millions, literally in Israel alone, 2 million CDs we get. We got them in China for a quarter of a price. 2 million CDs. Every person I walk in the street in Israel, screaming, listen who I'm listening to, in a car, here, in the airport. Even the pilot, I just came back Sunday with Elal. Somebody was giving me a ride to Mons. He was sitting next to me on a plane. As we come out, we go to rent a car in National. We're looking for the long term, the air train, 2 stops in circle something. This is the car rental. We have to go with the train. A minute ride. We got to the train. We don't know to which direction to take. So I see a pilot standing over there. The guy asked him, do you know how to go to the National car rental? He said, yeah, 2 stops on this side. How are you, Rabbi, the pilot? The pilot of the plane in Hebrew. We just came from Elal. Even to the pilot he got. It got to the judges in the court. In the court, in the government. I speak to people in the government. I tell them what to say, what to do, what not to do. Where could you do things like this 20 years ago? It went to everybody. A lot of people are aware now. Still a lot more work to do. But it came to a lot of people. A lot of people become closer to the religion. They keep, they already understand. There's so much more to do. You have CDs, take advantage on them. When you're in a car, don't listen to news, no sport, no songs, no nothing. It's all burning your life and time. Always CD. You drive from here to Manhattan, an hour in traffic, 1 hour Torah, 60,000 mitzvot. What mitzvot you get listening to the news? What mitzvot? Zero. What mitzvah you get listening to songs? Zero. 1 hour Torah to go, 1 hour to come back, 120,000 mitzvot every day. This alone can save you in Olam Haba. Plus, you become a better Jew. You listen, you do. Tomorrow you listen again, you do more. Listening to sport, you're going to get anywhere? You're not going to get anywhere. Without learning, nobody knows what to do. Without doing, you can never be tzaddik. Bezrat Hashem will be stronger and stronger. Thank you very much and have a great Shabbat. Shabbat Shalom.